नहीं देना है।
हाँ बिल्कुल बिल्कुल,
स्टार्ट हो गया
सर स्टार्ट हो गया सर, ये मोबाइल पर
सो गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। सो टुडे वी विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट स्लीप डिसऑर्डर्स। सो व्हाट इज स्लीप? स्लीप इज अ रिवर्सिबल स्टेट ऑफ डिक्रीज कॉन्शियसनेस दैट इज रिकरेंट एंड एसोसिएटेड विद कैरेक्टरिस्टिक बायोफिजियोलॉजिकल ऑल्टरेशंस। सो अनलाइक कोमा, स्लीप इज अ प्रोसेस दैट इज फिजियोलॉजिक recurrent and reversible. So we have to see why sleep is important. Sleep is a part of our life which is restorative to mind as well as body, and it is essential for physiological functions such as hormone secretion, growth and maintenance. So you all must have read about sleep in physiology as well, where you can see that growth hormone levels are higher during sleep because it leads to maintenance and growth of the body and just restorative functions. It is essential to maintain proper mental processes such as memory. During sleep, we have both long and short term memory consolidation, and sleep also leads to socially acceptable personality traits because sleep deprivation leads to change in personality as well. So there are two types of sleep which we can understand. One is non-REM sleep, one is REM sleep. Non-REM means non-rapid eye movement, and REM means rapid eye movement sleep. So there are some basic differences between these two stages of sleep, non-REM and REM. So basically, if we understand the difference between these two stages, REM is associated with autonomic abnormalities such as irregular heart rate, irregular respiratory rate, change in blood pressure and sexual changes. If we see the ventilatory response, that means ventilatory response means that whatever amount of respiration will increase depending upon the rise in CO2. So if our body CO2 level rises during REM sleep, the change in respiratory rate is less as compared to during non-REM sleep. That is, ventilatory response to CO2 is reduced during the duration of REM sleep. During REM sleep, brain is actually awake as compared to non-REM sleep. So brain oxygen consumption is more during REM sleep while it is less during non-REM sleep. And the skeletal muscle tone. So if you see, during REM, our body goes into atonia. That means all muscles go into reduction in their tone except the diaphragm. So these are the few variable differences between REM and non-REM sleep. So what non-REM sleep does, it leads to physical restoration of body, while REM leads to mental restoration. During non-REM, it is the homeostatic pressure. The brain is quiet, but body is active. That means brain oxygen consumption is less, but our body muscle activity is more. But during non-REM sleep, the brain is active and body goes into a state of atonia. So what are the stages of sleep? So as we discussed that we have two types of sleep, non-REM sleep and REM sleep. Non-REM sleep is divided into three stages, stage 1, stage 2 and stage 3, and then we have REM. And one stage of sleep is wake. So we have total 5 stages: wake, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3 and REM. So there are various EEG waves which can classify sleep into these stages. First is the alpha activity. Alpha is very high frequency, which is usually up to 13 to 17. That means there is very sharp activity. This is known as alpha activity. This happens in our brain during awake period. As soon as a person goes into sleep, when sleep starts from awake to stage 1, the brain activity slows down. If you can compare this alpha and theta, the theta activity is slower than the alpha activity. So this is theta activity, which has a frequency of 4 to 7. This is known as low amplitude mixed frequency. That means amplitude of the waves is considerably lower as compared to during the wake, and frequency is also slowed down. When a person goes from stage 1 to stage 2, there are the frequency nearly remains the same, that is the low amplitude mixed frequency, but we have what we call as sleep spindle and K complex. Sleep spindles means there are very sharp waves. If you see, the entire thing is running, but we have very sharp high frequency waves that is, and very small in duration. These are known as sleep spindles. And then we have K complexes. K complexes is that there is one negative deflection and a large positive slow deflection. This is known as K complexes. So sleep stages and sleep spindle and K complex are characteristic of stage 2 sleep. Once we go into deep sleep or slow wave sleep is the stage 3. In this stage, the frequency goes further down. If you see, now we have even slow frequency. The frequency is usually 0.5 to 2 hertz during the stage 3. It is known as the delta activity. So this is delta activity. If your sleep study has more than 20% delta activity, it is classified as stage 3. During stage 3, the waves are slow, but their amplitude is big. It is important to see that this amplitude is bigger than the previous waves. This is known as delta activity. And then we go into the REM. So previously stage 3 and stage 4 were classified separately, but now we have classified them both as 1, and we call it as stage 3 only. And then we have REM sleep. REM sleep means you have a theta activity, that is low amplitude mixed frequency, along with you have rapid eye movements, which we can pick up with the electrooculogram, which we will see in future further slides, that how does a sleep study is done. So if we look at sleep physiology, this is the sleep hypnogram of a 23-year-old boy, and this is hypnogram of a 68-year. So what is hypnogram? Hypnogram means you record sleep and then you stage sleep. So this is the staging of sleep, that awake, REM, N1, N2, N3, and that's when it's shown in a picture with a long time. It is known as hypnogram. So if you see the difference between a hypnogram of a young male versus an older person, so the sleep starts early in older age and it ends early as compared to a young person, where the sleep cycle is a little delayed. Okay, number one. Then you have fixed periods of REM sleep. So REM sleep usually starts after 1.5 hours of non-REM sleep, and then it keeps recurring. So there are stages of non-REM. While REM sleep reduces in the elderly population, the sleep fragmentation means the change of sleep and awakening is much more in the elderly population. If you see, the stage comes back to awake. This is known as the sleep fragmentation, which is more common in elderly as compared to a young population. So there are few basic physiological differences between young and elderly population. So what are our sleep requirements? An average adults require 7 to 8 hours of sleep, and people who sleep less than 4 hours or more than 9 hours have increased risk of coronary artery disease, cancer and stroke. What can sleep deprivation lead to? So sleep deprivation can lead to short-term as well as long-term consequences. Short-term consequences include impaired attention and concentration, accidents, reduced productivity and road traffic accidents. While long-term consequences are far more outreaching, which includes coronary artery disease, heart failure, hypertension, obesity, stroke, type 2 diabetes and depression. So this slide actually tells us the importance of our sleep, which should be 7 to 8 hours of sleep for any young healthy individuals. So how do we classify sleep disorders? So sleep disorders can be classified into various classes. So what we will be predominantly discussing today is the sleep related breathing disorders. Sleep related breathing disorders have a spectrum of disease which we will see. They predominantly include obstructive sleep apnea and central sleep apnea. Then we have disorders of hypersomnia, that is increased sleep, which can be narcolepsy or it can be idiopathic hypersomnia, or it can be due to insufficient sleep disorder. Insufficient sleep disorder means a person presents to us with hypersomnia, that is increased sleep, but if we look at his sleep schedule, we find that he is actually not sleeping adequately during night, so he has increased sleep during daytime, which is common in students, residents, that they have sleep during daytime. Then we have disorders of insomnia, that is inability to sleep. It can be idiopathic or it can have associated features. Depression and psychiatric disorders are one of the very common causes of insomnia. Even obstructive sleep apnea can lead to insomnia. Then we have parasomnia. Parasomnias are divided into non-REM parasomnias and REM parasomnias and some other associated features, which we will see in the end of this presentation. So first we come to sleep disordered breathing, which is the basic topic of today's class. So sleep is a physiological state associated with marked changes in ventilatory pattern. So what happens in a normal person during sleep, that there is decreased sensitivity of ventilation to hypercapnia and hypoxia. So if we think about physiology, if our body's CO2 level rises or oxygen level goes down, what will happen? Our brain get a signal and it leads to hyperventilation. That means our breathing depth as well as rate will increase. So that leads to hyperventilation and removal of this CO2 or increase in our oxygen. So this response is reduced during sleep in normal individuals as well. And individuals with obstructive sleep apnea, it is actually worse. And during REM, it is worse as compared to non-REM sleep. So there is decreased sensitivity to hypercapnia and hypoxia, and there is reduced muscle tone specifically in the REM sleep. So this leads to desaturation. The predominant sleep disorders include sleep apnea, which can be obstructive, or central sleep apnea, and there are hypoventilation syndromes, which we will see that what are these. What is obstructive sleep apnea? So obstructive sleep apnea has three components. First is obstructive, then sleep, and then apnea. So apnea means cessation of respiration. Sleep apnea means cessation of respiration during sleep. And obstructive sleep apnea means cessation of breathing during sleep due to an obstructed airway. So it is an intrinsic sleep disturbance characterized by the appearance of repeated episodes of upper airway obstruction occurring during sleep, usually associated with reduction in blood oxygen saturation. And it is most common intrinsic dyssomnia leading to hypersomnia. And so what is happening is that there is an ongoing epidemic of obesity, which is leading to increased prevalence of obstructive sleep apnea. OSA is frequently unrecognized and undiagnosed because patients as well as treating physicians don't suspect it. If they don't suspect it, they don't find it and they don't treat it. But it leads to significant morbidity and mortality. What is the spectrum of sleep disordered breathing? Sleep disordered breathing spectrum goes from habitual snorers till hypoventilation syndrome. So we have individuals who have snoring, which is more than 3 times per week, but there is no obstructive apneas in them. So these are known as habitual snorers. What is OSA? That means if we have to perform a overnight polysomnography, and these individuals have a AHI. What is AHI? AHI means apnea and hypopnea events per hour of sleep. So once we perform a polysomnography, we record the respiration as well. So during that respiration record, we see that there are some periods of apnea, that is cessation of respiration, and there are some periods of hypopnea. Hypopnea means reduction in the respiration. So depth of respiration will go down. There are definitions given for apnea and hypopnea. If the respiration is stopped more than 90% of its amplitude, it is known as apnea. If it is between 30 to 90%, it is called as hypopnea. So once we find this hypopnea and apnea during polysomnography, we record it, we score it, एंड देन वी गिव इट एन इंडेक्स, दैट इज अमाउंट ऑफ एपनिया प्लस हाइपोपनिया पर आवर ऑफ स्लीप, दैट इज नोन एज AHI. If a normal individual can also have some degree of apnea and hypopnea during sleep, so AHI of less than 5 is considered normal. If AHI goes above 5, it is called as obstructive sleep apnea. We'll see what is the severity of it. So apnea hypopnea index between 5 to 15 is classified as mild, between 15 to 30 is classified as moderate, and more than 30 is classified as severe obstructive sleep apnea. So any individual who has AHI on a polysomnography more than 5 is called to have OSA. So, and what is OSAS? That is obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. Any individual who has a sleepiness along with AHI more than 5. Sleepiness is defined as ESS, that is Epworth sleepiness scale of more than 10. If you have a patient who has excessive daytime sleepiness, you perform a polysomnography, you found that his AHI is more than 5, you will classify that patient as OSAS. And there is an extreme of sleep disorder breathing that is known as obesity hypoventilation syndrome. What happens in obesity hypoventilation means patient has obesity, number one. Obesity means BMI is more than 30 as per international standards. Then we have evidence of hypoventilation. Hypoventilation means your CO2 level rises due to hypoventilation. So any individual who has a BMI of more than 30, his PCO2 level during daytime is more than 45 millimeters of mercury, and they have evidence of sleep disorder breathing. And we have excluded other causes of hypoventilation such as muscle disease or COPD, then they are classified as obesity hypoventilation syndrome. So this is the entire spectrum of sleep disorder breathing. If we look at OSA in India, the population prevalence estimated is 3.5 on different studies, but it is a very large population which is affected, which is we all don't understand. What are the independent risk factors? One is male gender, BMI more than 25, abdominal obesity, and increased waist hip ratio. These are the risk factors for OSA. So OSA prevalence and obesity association, it is very important for all of us to understand that obesity is associated with increased prevalence of OSA. One standard deviation increase in BMI leads to 4-4 increase in the obstructive sleep apnea. A 10% increase in weight leads to 32% increase in AHI. If somebody who has a weight of 60 kg and it goes to 66 kg, his AHI will increase from maybe 30 to around 40. So that's how the association of weight and AHI and obstructive sleep apnea is. So weight reduction, 10% weight reduction is associated with 26% reduction in AHI. So weight reduction forms a very important component of treatment of patients with obesity, obstructive sleep apnea associated with obesity. Why does obstructive sleep apnea occur? So obstructive sleep apnea, as we have understood, there is apnea, that is cessation of respiration during sleep, but where is the obstruction? So this slide shows you where is the obstruction. So this is a sagittal section of our face, this is nose, upper lip, lower lip, tongue, and this is the palate and uvula. So this is how the breathing occurs, through nose as well as through mouth, and this is the pathway for air to enter the lower airway. What happens during sleep? Muscle tone decreases, this falls below, this tongue falls behind, and what happens, the airway is narrowed. So this narrowed airway can lead to hypopnea, that means the caliber of the airway is smaller, it may lead to hypopnea, and if there is complete blockage of this airway, it leads to apnea. This is the basic physiology of anatomical contribution to occurrence of obstructive sleep apnea. So during awake we have a normal airway, during sleep it reduces, it leads to hypopnea, and during sleep it can go totally down leading to apnea. So obstructive sleep apnea leads to sleep fragmentation. Sleep fragmentation leads to increased sympathetic activity. What happens? As soon as you go to sleep, you develop an apnea, brain gets in signal that breathing is not happening, brain gets awake, that is sleep fragmentation. Once brain gets awake, it leads to sympathetic activity, that means we have to increase our sympathy. So heart rate increases, that increase in heart rate leads to increase in blood pressure and increase in vascular resistance. So all these consequently lead to increased atherosclerosis and cardiovascular disease. So why we are studying obstructive sleep apnea? If we see, this is a graph which shows survival probability on y-axis and years on the x-axis. And the various color codes are given for individuals with different AHI, that is less than 5, is that is no obstructive sleep apnea, mild OSA, moderate OSA and severe OSA. If we see, patients without OSA have a higher probability of survival as compared to mild, moderate and severe OSA. So we can see that as the severity of obstructive sleep apnea increases, the probability of survival goes down. That means it's a disease which is killing people. So it is important for us to understand that it is not a disease which can be just neglected. We need to look into this disease, diagnose it and treat it properly. What are the cardiovascular consequences of obstructive sleep apnea? It can lead to hypertension, coronary artery disease, heart failure, cardiac arrhythmia, stroke, pulmonary hypertension and right heart failure, and it can lead to sudden death as well. So what are the odds ratio of obstructive sleep apnea causing these problems? In individuals with OSA, the odds ratio for prevalent hypertension is 1.4. For incident hypertension, it is 2.9. They have 1.3 times chance of coronary artery disease, 4.5 stroke, congestive heart failure 2.7 and vehicular accident 7. So these are all the problems that can occur in patients with untreated obstructive sleep apnea, and it can lead to sudden death as well. What are the neurocognitive deficits? So it is very important for us to understand that this sleep, as we saw in the initial slide, sleep is very important for the restoration of our body as well as mind. Once there is sleep fragmentation and sleep deprivation due to obstructive sleep apnea, what happens? The entire body function goes down. So there is effect on each and entire body part. The most important parts which we have to understand is the cardiovascular, and secondly is the neurocognitive. Neurocognitive will also include our behavioral problems. So patients with obstructive sleep apnea have delayed information processing. Supposedly there is impaired concentration. You are talking to a person who has OSA and it untreated, there may be impaired concentration. You may be talking to them, but they are not able to listen. They are not able to understand or process whatever you are telling them. So there is attention deficiency. There is impaired fine visual motor coordination. So individuals with OSA have increased sleepiness and decrease in their fine work. So we have get patients who actually are cutting vegetables in home and they cut their fingers because they are having incoordination and sleepiness. There can be vehicular accident. Vehicular accident is one of the most dangerous complication of OSA. So patients, drivers and individuals who drive, if they have any symptom to suggest OSA, they should get themselves evaluated and treated rather than engaging in a vehicular accident. So any individual with OSA who gets into a vehicular accident should be avoiding driving, although we don't have any law for this right now in our country. It can lead to memory deficits. It can lead to mood impairment, depression, anxiety. So it is very important for us to understand that these symptoms are very common in the society, and we have to find that what is the reason for these symptoms. So every individual who presents with any of these problems, we should look into the component of OSA in their history and examination. What are the metabolic effects of obstructive sleep apnea? So there is something called as metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome has multiple components. Once a patient with OSA has metabolic syndrome, it's known as syndrome Z or syndrome Z. Metabolic syndrome is 4 times more common in patients with OSA as compared to patients without OSA, and metabolic syndrome increases with the severity of OSA. So male gender, age, increased body fat and nocturnal desaturation are independent risk factors for occurrence of metabolic syndrome as well. So if we see, the components of metabolic syndrome include diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia and obesity, and here also we can have syndrome Z, that is the obstructive sleep apnea. So that entire syndrome Z has all these components. So it is important that once you have a patient of obstructive sleep apnea, they are at high risk of developing diabetes, hypertension, dyslipidemia. So this is a cycle which goes on and on, and patients, if they are not treated in time, it can lead to life-threatening consequences. what is the relation between BMI and obstructive sleep apnea? So 40% of obese individuals have OSA, and 70% of OSA patients are obese. So there is still a 30% population of OSA patients who are not obese, in which the upper airway anatomy as well as the brain signals play an important role in the pathogenesis of obstructive sleep apnea. So how do we approach a sleepy patient? Supposedly now, once we have understood the pathophysiology of OSA, a patient who comes to us with increased sleepiness, how can we evaluate him? So the evaluation will include history examination, subjective assessment of sleepiness, objective assessment of sleepiness, and few other tests. What are the differential diagnoses once a patient comes to us with increased sleepiness? The most important differential is insufficient sleep. That is, individual is not sleeping well during night time and he has increased daytime sleepiness. Then we have to look for other disorders such as sleep related breathing disorders, circadian rhythm disorders, sleep related movement disorders, central disorders, idiopathic hypersomnia, some of the medical disorders such as Parkinson's, multiple sclerosis, depression, anxiety, somatoform disorders, and some of the medication and substance abuse can also lead to increased sleepiness. So this is the basic list of things which we should come in mind once we think of hypersomnolence or increased sleepiness in any patient. We have to take a detailed sleep history, which should be supplemented by the bed partner, family members, or the roommate. Sometimes patient may himself not be aware of the problems he has during sleep, but the bed partner, wife, spouse, patient, spouse of the patient, or somebody in the family can tell that he snores very well, or his breathing stops during night time, or he has night time awakening, or he walks during sleep. So all this history has to come from the patient as well as the members of the family or spouse of the patient. We have to go into the family history. The sleep history actually includes that you have to take the entire schedule of the person, that what time he goes to bed, what time he gets up in the morning, what happens during that night time, is he having repeated awakening during night, how many times he has to go for urination during night, has its frequency changed over the time, and does he feel fresh when he gets up in the morning, any headache in the morning, any throat pain in the morning. So this throat pain, headache, feeling of non-refreshing sleep, these all are the symptoms. The person's sleep is not sufficient for him and there is some problem. If he feels sleepy during daytime, somebody is working and whether he has to sleep for 20-30 minutes during day, otherwise he cannot work. So these all tells you about the severity and presence of problem, that there is definitely a problem. We have to go into the family history about narcolepsy, restless leg syndrome. We have to look for travel history. Travel history means somebody who has traveled for a long flight, after that they have jet lag, that can lead to circadian rhythm disorder, jet lag disorder. That means your sleep cycle has actually changed and it takes some time for the sleep to get normal. And we have to take history of regarding current or previous medical illnesses, as we all talked about, like diabetes, blood pressure, coronary artery disease, stroke, and psychiatric or any neurological illnesses. So how do we assess the sleepiness? So subjective sleepiness means the patient will score that how sleepy he is. So for subjective sleepiness, we have what we call as Epworth sleepiness scale. Epworth sleepiness scale has multiple questions, from 8 questions, and the score is given from 0, 1, 2, 3, depending upon how often a patient feels this. Like somebody is sitting and reading and they feel sleepy all the time, then the score becomes 3. So a patient should be given this questionnaire to fill, and then we find out what is the sleepiness. If the maximum score here is 24, and then in this 24 score, if any individual has a sleepiness score of more than 10, that suggests there is increased sleepiness and we need to take the patient up for a polysomnography. Then there are other ways like Stanford sleepiness scale as well. The one of the very important and easiest questionnaire which we can use for assessing the risk for obstructive sleep apnea is stop bank questionnaire. Stop bank questionnaire has 8 components. S for snoring, that means do you snore loudly? Yes, no. Number 2 is T for tired, that means do you often feel tired or sleepy during daytime? Yes, no. Observed means has anybody in your family observed that your breathing stops during night? and whether you have blood pressure disease. So these are the four components of stop. And we have bang. Bang means BMI is more than 35, age more than 50, neck circumference more than 40 centimeters, and gender male. So these are the very easy to do and on bedside 8 questions. And if the answer to any of 3 or more items is yes, then patient is at high risk of OSA. And if answer to less than 3 items, it is low risk of OSA. So it's a very important screening tool which we use very often in our clinical practice to assess the risk of obstructive sleep apnea. Then we have some other questionnaires like Berlin questionnaire as well. Sleep diary is also a subjective assessment of sleepiness. Sleep diary means you allow charting of daily sleep and wake time for at least 2 consecutive weeks, and review of this information allows the clinician to estimate the total amount of sleep the patient obtains in 24-hour period. It gives us information about the patient's sleep habits. So this is an example of a sleep diary. You have date, day, and the entire 24 hours are scaled here. So person will tell that this time I went to sleep, this time I woke up, at this time I had food, then I went out, I took my medication, I went to sleep at 11 o'clock, then I was sleeping till 6 o'clock, or I had to go for urine in between 2 times. So this actually tells you what is the usual schedule of a person, and this is very important tool to identify whether there is insufficient sleep. So if somebody who is sleeping for like 4 hours from 11 o'clock to 3 o'clock only, and the entire morning they are awake, that means they are insufficiently sleeping, and then the patient will say that I am having increased sleep here. So that's how you assess the sleep history of a patient. Now we come to the objective assessment, that means how can we measure sleep. So the gold standard for measuring sleep is a polysomnography. Then we have multiple sleep latency tests, maintenance of wakefulness test, and actigraphy. This is the most commonly performed test for assessment of sleep. MSLT means MSLT is done to assess the patient's ability to sleep. So sleep latency we have to find out. If patient's sleep latency, that means time into bed till the patient is sleeping, that is known as sleep latency. If sleep latency is decreased, it tells us the patient has high chances of increased sleepiness. So what is polysomnography? Polysomnography is a multi-channel study where we put so many channels to the patient and then we record their sleep. What are the common channels include? EEG, that means we have to put leads on the patient's head. Then we have electrooculogram. We have EMG on the mental and submental surfaces. We have ECG electrodes. We have airflow, that means patient's breathing is measured with a nasal pressure and oral thermistor. Then we have thoracic and abdominal effort breaths. That means when patient is breathing, how his abdomen and chest is moving. Then we have leg EMG. We have arterial oxygen saturation monitoring, and we have body position sensors. So these are the sensors which we routinely monitor during a sleep study. So this is the basic preparation for a sleep study. These are the leads. These are the jelly which are used to attach leads to the patient. These are thoracic and abdominal belt. This is a snore monitor. It records snoring. This is a thermistor where we have to record the flow through the mouth. So this is the polysomnography machine where we have various channels, and all the leads which we saw in the previous slides get attached here so that it is recorded on a computer. I'll not go into the great details of how we do it. Then we can have video camera also. So patients who have abnormal movements during sleep, who have sleep walking, sleep eating problems, so those individuals can be assessed with use of a video camera during sleep. So this is an infrared camera. Even when lights are off, it can record. And it is not mandatory to use a video camera for all sleep studies, but it is good if we have it. So that's how we prepare a patient. We clean the patient's head and face with alcohol-based solution so that the leads get stuck. So we prepare the leads, we put them on patient's head. We put the EEG leads, we put the channels. This is how it is. This is the body position belts. That means it tells you whether patient is lying supine, lateral, or prone. These are the belts which tell you about the chest effort and abdominal effort. Then we have this sensor for the nasal pressure flow, that means it records the breathing of the patient. Then this is the EMG belt for EMG leads for lower limb anterior tibialis muscle, EMG is recorded. So that's how we perform a polysomnography. So there are various types of polysomnography from level 1 to level 4. What we saw right now was the level 1 sleep study, that is, it has all the channels which are required and it has a technician who is available there. So we can have various other levels of sleep study also with some minimum number of channels. But what we commonly perform here is the type 1. We can have modified, that means we can perform sleep studies at home without a technician with limited number of channels. I'll not be going into the details of this, but you should know that there are 4 levels of sleep study and the gold standard is level 1, where we have at least 7 channels, that is ECG, EEG, EOG, EMG, airflow, respiratory effort and oxygen saturation. So as we previously discussed, what is apnea? So any decrease in thermal sensor excursion by more than 90%, that means amplitude of your thermistor goes to less than 90%, less than 10%, and the duration of the event is 10 seconds or more, it is scored as apnea. Like this, if you have this oro nasal thermal flow, this was the normal breathing and it goes down and it is nearly flat right now, for a duration is 24 seconds, it is called as an apnea. This is also an apnea. So what then we have hypopnea as well. We'll see in future slides what are the hypopnea. Then we have mixed apnea. Mixed apnea means so apneas are defined, if we see here, so this is an apnea, but what we're seeing, the chest and abdomen belts, this is the chest effort, that means chest movements, and these are abdominal movements. So once we have an apnea, but chest and abdomen continue to show movement, that means that our chest and abdomen are moving, trying to take a breath, but we are not able to take a breath because there is an obstruction. So this is defined as an obstructive sleep apnea. But if we have an apnea, but there is no effort in chest or abdomen, it is called as central apnea. So like this slide, it has apnea, but there is no effort in the thoracic belt or abdominal belt, it is called as central apnea. Then we go to the mixed apnea, that is, it has some component which is central and some component which is obstructive. So if this part, this shows an apnea, there is flattening of chest as well as abdominal belt, it is the central apnea. But at the end of it, what happens, the central apnea is gone, but now we have reduced, we have some chest movements, but apnea continues. So it is called as mixed apnea, that means this component is central and this component is obstructive, that is mixed apnea. What is hypopnea? Hypopnea means that when the nasal pressure signal goes more than 30% down and duration is also more than 10 seconds, but an hypopnea is associated with 3% or more oxygen desaturation. We see here, so we have flow here, that is nasal flow, so the breathing was like this and it has now gone down, and what we have to see here, that the saturation was 99-90%, and now you see the saturation has gone down to 85%. So this reduction in flow has led to desaturation, is classified as hypopnea, and this is where we see the central sleep apnea, that means airflow is gone and effort is also gone, that is known as the central sleep apnea. So that's how we score sleep on a sleep study. Now we come to the another important disease, that is narcolepsy. It's a rare disease, but it's important for all of us to understand. You'll get a lot of MCQs on narcolepsy during your entrance exams commonly. So narcolepsy is a disease where the sleep latency is reduced, that is, patients have increased sleepiness, but what happens, there is sleep onset REM. So if when we saw the initial hypnograms, we see that person goes from sleep to N1, and after 1.5 hours of nearly 90 minutes of non-REM sleep, they get the first REM sleep. What happens in narcolepsy individuals, the REM comes early. So within 20 minutes of initial sleep, patient goes into REM, and it continues to happen throughout night. And what happens in REM? In REM, we all know that there is loss of muscle body tone, that is sleep paralysis, and there is frequent awakening. So, and because obstructive sleep apnea is also worse during REM sleep. So these individuals have sleep onset REM period and reduce sleep latency with some other associated features. Then we have PLMS, that means the periodic limb movement syndrome. So this can be picked up on the leg EMG. So if you see, there are repeated contractions of leg muscles. During sleep, the leg muscle activity should be very less. So individuals who have leg movement disorder, they will have repeated leg movements. This can be picked up on the polysomnography. Now, after polysomnography, we come to the multiple sleep latency test. Multiple sleep latency test is an objective measure of excessive sleepiness. What happens? A person sleeps overnight in the sleep lab, and during the coming morning, what we actually do that we put a patient with the machine connected, and we ask them to sleep. So once a person is asked to stay in a quiet room, we'll see how long does it take for them to sleep. So if the duration is less than 20 minutes, that means there is reduced sleepiness. There is increased sleepiness. So lower the sleep latency, higher the chances of sleepiness. So with this tool, MSLT, we can measure the patient's sleep latency, and we can also look at the REM onset periods. So individuals who have narcolepsy, on MSLT, we will find that within 20 minutes of onset of their sleep, they will go into REM sleep. So this test is commonly performed for assessment of sleepiness and for patients with suspected narcolepsy. Then we have one tool which is known as actigraphy. Actigraphy means, it has two words, acti and graphy. Acti means activity and graphy means recording. So you have recording of a person's activity. So it is like a wristwatch. We all have seen such kind of monitors. So we have a wristwatch kind of thing which tells you about the movement of a person. So it only records the movement, and if we see that a person, there is no activity, we presume that it is sleeping. Number two, it can also assess the time, light. So it takes two things into consideration, whether you have light or no light, and whether there is activity or no activity. Based upon that, it tells you what time did the person sleep, what time did he wake up, what were the movements in between, and whether he was sleeping during the daytime or the night time also. So actigraphy is a very useful tool for individuals with insomnia. So for individuals with sleep disorders, we can do some other blood tests also, like CBC, blood chemistry, thyroid profile, screening for drugs like stimulants, opiates, benzodiazepines. We have to perform iron studies for patients with restless leg syndrome. We have to do neuroimaging if we have any history of trauma or we have any abnormal neurological findings, because some neurological disorders can present with sleep disorders initially. And sometimes we have to do psychiatric evaluation for depression, mood disorders, psychosis or conversion disorders. So how do we diagnose OSA? We have a clinical suspicions, we take history, we do examination, we do clinical subjective questionnaires, and then we take the patient for a polysomnography. But what is important is we have to rule out hypothyroidism in individuals with OSA, and we have to look for anatomical problems. There may be some individuals who have small mandible, small maxillas, they have some abnormality here. So that can lead to worsening of obstructive sleep apnea. So how do we manage sleep apnea? Sleep apnea, basically lifestyle and behavioral modification. We have CPAP, we have positional therapy and oral appliances like mandibular advancement, and we have surgical options for upper airway surgery as well as for weight reduction. We can take UBS patients for a bariatric surgery. So this is the chart which shows that how do you mild, moderate and severe patients. Mild asymptomatic patients can be treated only with lifestyle modification, but if patients have mild obstructive sleep apnea but they have symptoms, they need to be treated with CPAP. And patients with moderate and severe disease should be given option of a CPAP therapy. If they are not able to tolerate CPAP, oral appliances like mandibular advancement devices, BiPAP or surgery can be an option for these patients as well. In general measure, we should ask these patients to avoid alcohol and benzodiazepine, and they should be able to maintain sleep hygiene, that is a consistent bedtime and wake up time. That means they should not be going into bed using phone. If we go to bed at 11 o'clock and they are using their phone till 1 o'clock, their sleep habits are very erratic. So that should be given. Individuals with insufficient sleep syndrome should be asked to have an adequate sleep time. Even if they go to bed at 12 o'clock, they should give time from 6.5-7 hours sleep at least, so that their daytime sleepiness goes away. Then comes the role of a CPAP, that is the positive air, continuous positive airway pressure. That remains the mainstay of treatment for patients with moderate to severe OSA. Multiple trials have shown that individuals with obstructive sleep apnea improve with PAP therapy, but in mild OSA patients there are less trials. But in patients who have mild obstructive sleep apnea but they have symptoms, it is associated with improved function and quality of life, improved daytime alertness, mood, as well as diastolic blood pressure. So the indications of PAP therapy includes moderate to severe obstructive sleep apnea and mild sleep apnea with symptoms or associated comorbid conditions. What is the way PAP therapy works? It leads to pneumatic sprinting. That means once you have sleep, we saw that the upper tongue or the uvula falls behind and leads to closure. So what happens once this pressure is applied, the airway opens and it allows for breathing to happen. So this is an obstructed airway, and this is after application of PAP, you see the airway dimension increases. So there are various oral appliances which are available. These are custom made. It means usually the orthodontist or the prosthodontists help us in preparing these for patients. Then we have some parasomnia like narcolepsy. Narcolepsy has daytime sleepiness, cataplexy. It has hallucinations which are hypnagogic, that means while falling asleep, and there is sleep paralysis. It is second most common cause of disabling daytime sleepiness, but it is uncommon in India. We see few patients of narcolepsy, but probably the prevalence is much less in our country as compared to the Western world. Then we have another disease which is known as the restless leg syndrome. Restless leg syndrome is also known as the Willis-Ekbom disease. It is a common movement disorder. So now we have, first initially we saw the breathing disorder. This is a movement disorder where the patient has unpleasant or uncomfortable urge to move the legs, and it occurs during periods of inactivity. As soon as the person goes to bed or he sits, he feels that he has to move his leg. It is worse in evening, and as soon as he starts moving his legs, it is better. During sleep, most patients with RLS have periodic limb movements, which we saw in the previous slide, that if we connect the leg EMG, we can identify these periodic limb movements. Now we come to the parasomnias. Parasomnia are undesirable physical events or experiences that occur during sleep, within sleep, or during the arousals of sleep. It may occur during non-REM sleep, REM sleep, as well as during transition. They are common and they are usually not related to any psychiatric disorders. So there is a classification for parasomnia. You have non-REM parasomnias like confusional arousal, sleepwalking, sleep terrors. You have parasomnias during REM sleep like REM behavioral disorder, REM associated paralysis, or nightmare disorders. REM, rapid eye movement sleep behavior disorder, can be a harbinger of neurodegenerative disorder like Parkinson's disease. So patients who have RBD early can later go on to develop Parkinson's disease. And there are various other parasomnia as well, which I will not be going into details. So just to conclude about the sleep disorder, sleep disorder breathing has multi-system effects. It is associated with metabolic syndrome. Polysomnography remains the gold standard for diagnosis, and basics of scoring of a polysomnograph is essential to understand sleep disorder breathing, and CPAP remains the standard of care for patients with obstructive sleep apnea. Thank you.